Years 2508-2510. Scourge, grief, wounds.
In the days and months that followed, the survivors had to come to terms with what they had lost and what sort of future they faced. The frontier colonies were a far cry from the grand majesty of Earth or the cradle worlds, and many had a hard time adjusting. For the locals' part, their isolated and backwater existence had suddenly become the focus of humanity's very survival and a haven for millions of refugees. These early days were marked with tension not only among the survivors and the natives, but in the very minds of all who lived, many of whom anxiously awaited the arrival of an enemy invasion fleet on the skies above. Armed forces were virtually non-existent, and almost no meaningful fleet of ships remained. The colonies were utterly defenseless. Fortunately, the much-dreaded invasion never came, and it seemed that measures taken to seal the colonies off from Earth and the Great Walls had worked. Since the enemy ships were unable to simply jump into the colonies' locations, it was reckoned that the Scourge required full space nodes just as human ships did. This gave the survivors a measure of safety, although it also begged the question of how the invaders had attacked with eerie exactitude. Many would treat this as a small comfort only, as the colonies were rough, hard planets on which to eke out an existence, far from Earth normal in climate, gravity, and day-night cycles. However, they were rich in natural resources, and their hardened populations were able to adapt to the new reality with speed and gusto, in the face of a much greater threat than their fellow humans. One of the first tasks for the emerging leadership was to determine in detail the true nature of their new and terrible enemy. Reporting of the invasion had been chaotic, generating mountains of mixed and confusing intelligence that now had to be sorted urgently. It appeared that the aliens were carbon-based lifeforms not too dissimilar to Earth vertebrates in taxonomy. Whilst bearing a superficially lizard-like appearance, they were found to be warm-blooded oxygen breathers. The only puzzle that emerged was that the aspect of their nervous system appeared radically different biologically. While clearly part of the body, it shared little similarity with the rest on a cellular, chemical, and subjective level. In time, rare records of other vastly different and more monstrous species emerged, ranging from hulking bipedal juggernauts to sinuous worm-like beings with hundreds of razor-sharp limbs. What was most striking was the sheer variety of seemingly unrelated bioforms. Physical specimens were extremely rare, but those that were available shared the same curious discord between aspects of their nervous system and the rest of their biology. The designs of their constructs were more consistent in appearance, being hideously organic looking and sharing common design traits, indicating a united engineering style and method. The conclusion was quickly reached that the vehicles and ships of the enemy were constructed entities and not biological on the living sense. Although footage of destroyed constructs sometimes showed a black tar-like substance oozing from damaged sections. Unsurprisingly, only fragments were physically brought back, as intelligence gathering and scientific understanding were very low on the list of priorities for those fleeing from them. In time, a name for the enemy emerged, which will only reflect humanity's outlook and view on the terrible foe: the Scourge.